Hey y'all, welcome back to Right at the Wire. Well, as you can see, we've escaped the dungeon. Spring is here, and so we're outside for a nicer environment for posting. Got the hat on to welcome in spring and get excited for Belmont and Saratoga coming up, and I hope you're getting some spring fever for that as well. As part of our Belmont card series, we're going to be looking at the late pick four today for Thursday's card, so let's take a look at the sequence. First leg of the late pick four is the sixth race, and it's a state-bred maiden special weight for fillies and mares, three-year-olds and up, and they run it at about a mile and an eighth on the inner turf, and if you look at the configuration, you'll see it starts on a turn for the most part, so horses to the outside are a little bit of a disadvantage, particularly if they want to get up near the pace. Inside runners would have a little bit of an edge. Number one is Silent Melody. It's trained by Jorge Abreu, who is very good with second starts in the maiden special weight. He's at 26%, so that's obviously a plus. You also get a Rod Ortiz. You couldn't ask for a hotter jockey right now. The added panel shouldn't be a problem at all with Tonalist as the sire. This one idled mid-pack last time, and then he kind of settled in and made a decent move late, so it sort of looked like he was getting his bearings. I'll expect better in this one, and so I would definitely use. The Splendid One, you got Mark Hennig and Javier Castellano, so that's an upgrade jockey-wise for sure. That was a good race last time. Kusuki came back to run third in an allowance race and validated. He came off at a big price, so it turned out to be a pretty good race so far. This one saved ground. I mean, he was stalking along the rail all the whole time and just kind of flattened out a little bit, didn't have a whole lot of kick late, and that would be the concern I would have. It was the career high buyer for turf, the second time on turf. But aside from that, you see the dirt form is a little on the was okay, not great. Been in the maiden ranks for a while, and I'm not overly certain we could expect a better race next time, so I'm probably gonna pass. Dream on Cara hasn't run on turf since her two-year-old campaign. You see they started her on turf, and the first three were okay. Didn't really show a big-time progression. They have thought enough of this one to put her in some ungraded and restricted stakes, and she did okay. Nothing great. The big issue I have is that Central Banker is the sire, and you're asking a horse to go a mile and an eighth on the turf, who seems to be plateauing a little bit. I don't know that I see any room for improvement here, so I would probably pass on this one too. La Conquistadora will be likely the speed of the speed, early pace. It seems to be her MO. Two back in that race with Kusuki, she was the pace, and you see she wasn't able to hold it, but hung on okay for fifth. The big issue is that was a career high buyer and then followed it up at a shorter distance, which should have favored her style, and she regressed and fairly significantly. That was a pretty good race she was in, that's for sure, but it's not really a good sign, so I would look for this one to be pace only, and I would pass. Arasema is another one by Jorge Abreu, and is coming second off the layoff and a career high buyer. So there's some positives there. Stalked the leaders all the way around and was a decent third. The only thing I have a question about is that she appeared to be flattening out a little bit. The fourth place horse was really getting to her, and now you're asking to go a mile and an eighth. So I kind of wonder about that a little bit. Doesn't seem to be, if you look from the three-year-old form to four, that was a career-high buyer, but I don't know if that bodes for a big move forward here to break through. Seems to be plateauing a little bit. So I could go either way with this one, really. Starts now is pretty logical. Had a good start last time, and you see that was a debut at three with a career-high buyer and a pretty good one that is a winning type of figure for this race. Was getting to Kusuki late, but just couldn't quite close the deal. So you'd have to think a mile and an eighth and extra distance maybe will help a little bit. Is in good form, and the only, like I say, the one problem I have is that Mertgen Cantamarcy is not doing so well, at the meet, but who knows, maybe this one will get him over the top. It starts now as a logical use. Spurs is trained by Jimmy Bond, and this one came out with another one with a career high buyer, but it was at the maiden claiming level, and it's 10 points lower than the better horses in this race. And so I think this one would need another jump forward. It was an okay race, nothing to write home about. Given the hike up in class, I'm going to wait one on this one. Pinstripe Pizzo was interesting to me. It's trained by Horacio De Paz, and when it went out, got Jose Ortiz, so that's a big-time upgrade jockey-wise. Jose Ortiz really hot right now, just like his brother. The angle is the thing that's kind of interesting to me. Horacio De Paz is 1-for-5 with first-time blinkers, but he's 80% in the money. So that's a pretty serious angle, I would say. And so you'd have to think that adding the hood is going to definitely help. A little more distance probably is a good thing as well. This one would be more than likely a candidate for under, I think, but I could see using this one on top because you're probably going to get a pretty decent price. Bomb Squad, it's trained by Christophe Clement. You got Joel Rosario, in the iron. So those are both positives, of course. It's a good rider for Clement. You're adding blinkers for the first time, which is also a good angle. The thing is, I kind of expected better at 3 for a debut, and really was kind of a marginal improvement, not terribly much. And was in that same race with the others in here, and didn't really factor terribly much in it. I would expect a better race is probably likely. I would use more underneath than as a win candidate, but I certainly couldn't blame anybody if they want to use the 9. The 10 is She's a Natural. Right off the bat, Gary Siaka is a cold barn. He's 0-for-12 for the meet, so that's a big concern to me. However, he does go out and get Flavian Pratt, who's about as hot as you could get so far. The big thing, though, is you look at the last race, it was a career-high buyer, but it was only a point higher than the best, and that was at the 4-year-old debut. So you're not seeing that big-time progression on turf that you'd like to see. Obviously, that's the preferred surface. You see the dirt efforts haven't been so great. The last race, this one had to check early. It wasn't that big a deal, but came off slowly and came from all the way in the back, swept around the field, and closed really nicely. So you'd have to think the extra panel is definitely going to help this one's chances for sure. I do have a little bit of concern that this one won't be able to jack it up enough to get the win, but I think, with the right type of a setup, it's possible that this one could be a win candidate, but more under is probably more than likely. The second leg of the late pick four is the 7th race at Belmont. It's an optional claimer for 45,000 non-winners of 3 lifetime state bred fillies and mares, 3-year-olds and up, and it's run on the dirt at 1 1/16. The most important thing to note, of course, at Belmont, 1 1/16 races are one turn on the dirt. So horses with speed are at a bit of an advantage, and we always want to keep that in mind. Number 1 is Rybot's Valentine, a trade by Ray Handel. This one is stretching out to a route for the first time. Little surprise it's taken this long, being by Point of Entry and Dixieland Band underneath. Watch that last race in class here, and it was a pretty good third, and she did have the look of a horse that would probably want more ground. It just had that, didn't have that greasy burst of speed that you like to see with sprinters, more of a sustained type of run. And that to me says that this one would like a route a lot better. Putting blinkers on for the first time to sharpen up a little bit, and that's a pretty good angle for Ray Handel. So this one has some things to like. Being kind of a new shooter, a lot of these have run together multiple times. So there's also that, a new injection here. Maybe one to think about. BB's Busted is 59 starts, 17 seconds. So kind of hard to pick this one as a win candidate, especially when you consider hasn't won in 2 years. Just keeps piling up seconds. Now, Jeffrey Engelhard trains in second off the layoff is a really good angle for him. He's 44%, 72% in the money with a $4.38 ROI. If it was another horse, I'd be really excited about that, but you just can't be with all those seconds. You draw a line through the last race, probably needed one, and likely to run a good race here, but I think underneath is more likely. Busted Bay is in good form in class. The last three has been first, second, or third. Really no reason not to use. It's consistently competitive and a consistently running horse. There's just no reason not to use. I'd include this one as a win candidate. Sister Linda is kind of intriguing. Little inconsistent. Michelle Nevin trains, and the barn was going really well to start the meet. Kind of cooled off a little bit, but still doing pretty well. This one's coming off a fairly substantial couple-month layoff, and that's a good angle for Michelle. She's at 23%, so we like that. Prior to the layoff, this most recent one, she did get a win at 25,000, but the thing that concerns me is there's a bit of a Z pattern developing, kind of a good race, bad race thing. You look in class, ran a 30 up the track in September. They gave a freshening, ran a better race, an okay fifth, but then the second one off that layoff ran up the track again, freshened once again, came back and won at a lower class level. So you got to wonder about that to a degree. Now, if you go back to June of last year, this one ran a race at the N1X level that would probably win here. So this one has some ability and is capable of better with the layoff and the barn going pretty well. I mean, I think this is one you sort of have to include. But, there's some warning signs that of a bad race, too. Mia Bay Star is just not in good form right now. The last two haven't been terribly good at all, and I don't see anything to tell me that this one's form will improve. There's no layoff. There's no equipment change, nothing of that nature. So I'm going to pass. Excuse me. Amanda's Folly is trained by Linda Rice, and this one is... had been doing okay the last three starts. You see a couple of back-to-back wins and one at the N1X level. And did okay at the open company 40,000 level. But really the issue to me is the buyers look a little light. And more than anything else, as a three-year-old, not seeing that progression, that improvement. So this one seems to have plateaued a bit to me. And I just think there's others I appeal more, so I would pass. My First Love has one advantage in that she runs on the front end. There isn't a lot of early speed in this race, and you see two back at the N1X level. She wired the field at a one-turn mile, and that was a pretty good race. So this one has ability, and there's some things that's clearly should be an advantage here. The problem is... James Ferraro is 0-13 for the meets. The barn isn't going very well. The other thing is there is another Z pattern here. If you take the last four, 72, 67, 74, 63, that's never a really good sign. Now, you can say that a good race is in order if you follow the pattern correctly. So this one could perhaps run better, but it's kind of iffy to me. 8-1 is a good price. I wouldn't talk you out of it if you wanted to use, just based upon that. But usually when a barn's cold, I mean, nobody's running well. Cinderella's Cause is trained by Bob Falcone, conversely, is a hot barn right now. He's been doing really well. You get Manny Franco aboard, and they've been clipping at 21%. So that's all positive. The best thing about this one is three starts in a row. The class level has increased with each race, and so has... Cinderella Causes class level. She has run at a better class level as the class levels have increased for the last three races. That's about as positive a scenario as you could get. Now, you can say that a 69 buyer is a little light for this race, and that's true, but you also can look back and see this one has run better numbers. Has an 80 and a 76 under her belt, and in good form, another move is very possible. So at 8-1, I think this one's a pretty good price. And in a race that's not, you know, it's not really that form-fitting. I mean, I think there's a lot of options here. This is one maybe to upset the apple cart a little bit and you give a shot. third leg of the late pick four is the eighth race, and it's an optional claimer for $80,000 for non-winners of four lifetime, four-year-olds and up, and run on the turf at six furlongs. And we have a couple entry in here, and thankfully they've noted it with the post position, so I don't have to improvise here. But number one is Midday Image, the first half of the couple entry, and trained by David Jacobson, who's pretty hot right now, you'd have to say. He's 10 out of 16 in the money, and he's winning the 31%. You got a Rod Ortiz, about as hot a jockey as you can get. So that's a pretty lethal combination. They're winning at 50% in the meet. This one fits class-wise, coming off a solid win. And second off the layoff is a good spot for Jacobson as well, and he's good at turf sprints. No reason not to include. The only issue you do have is, as part of the couple entry, Rod is listed on both. So we'll have to see which one he actually runs with. I have a feeling it'll be this one, though. Super Success, trained by Fernando Abreu, and you got Javier Castellano aboard. And this looks like his first time running with this one. This one looks, a cut below, really, more than anything else. You're going to need a 90-plus buyer to win this race. This one hasn't registered one yet, and has done okay. The last race in a handicap at Gulfstream has done pretty well. I will note, though, a lot of times these horses leaving the Gulfstream turf haven't necessarily fared so great when they've shipped other places. So that's another knock as well, and I'll pass on this one. Mischievous Rogue is trained by Bill Cowens, and he is a Kentucky trainer. And so what's this horse doing here? That's the first question. He is very dangerous with shippers. Coming out of an N2X at Keeneland, this one had a nice win, and it seems to be heading in the right direction and progressing forward. Has been doing so throughout the five-year-old campaign, and just the fact that this horse is here, I think you absolutely have to use. Comedy Town is trained by Mike Maselli, and he's 0 for the meet so far, but this one is coming off a long layoff in the last race and did pretty well, was right in the mix until the very end and then just fell back, and that had the looks to me of a horse who just needed a race. Now, if you go back to the prior form, this one's a logical fit within here. Runs at a level competitive with these, and if you particularly look at that Laurel Dash, ran a really big race there. So I think with the freshening, this is again another one that you absolutely have to use, especially at 8-1, by the way. Gunnet is kind of intriguing. Linda Rice and Jose Ortiz are, great combination at this meet, hitting at 31%. Linda Rice is turf sprints all day long. But here's the thing. This one's got 10 seconds in 32 lifetime starts. It just never seems to get there. Has won $450,000, but that's $2.2 million away from the purchase price. So they got a way to make some money. Got a ways to go before they're going to get that. The last race, really, this one looked awful good to have a chance to win and just couldn't close the deal. And it seems to be a pattern with this one. Moving to turf seems to be a move more than anything to get this one a win. Linda Rice owns the horse and did claim it. So probably trying to make some of that money back. I could go either way with this one. On turf, I'm just not so sure. You just can't get away from all those seconds. So if you were going to use this one, I wouldn't blame you if you talk you out of it, but I would use advisedly. Heaven Street just came off of a really nice effort in the Elusive Quality. Led a pretty good field all the way, and just gave it up late to the top two. Now, that was at 7 furlongs, so you get a panel cutback here, which probably helps with the early running style. But the concern to me is that this one just ran a career-high buyer, and it was a significant move forward from anything that he had run before. So I'm a little concerned there might perhaps be a regression. At 6 furlongs, the running style it definitely moves this one up, I would say. It's a better fit than at 7 furlongs. And third off the layoff is a good spot for Brendan Walsh. His barn's been doing pretty well lately. But I just have some concerns about a regression. And so again, this is another one that I could see using, but I'd be it, to me, I'd be advisedly. Slipstream just doesn't look good enough to me. This Christophe Clément has been okay at this meet, not great by his standards. You see the last couple of races were not the greatest finishes. The last one in particular was pretty disappointing. So could this one move forward at 4 years old? It's possible, but looks a little cut below compared to the others in this field. C's Get Degrees is the other part of the half of the coupled entry, and you see also Irad Ortiz is signed on for this one. This one is in good form and has been running really well. Just got a win at the N2X level, but it was on dirt. So the shift to turf, you know, I could see this one being a fit. You don't have to worry about it too much because you definitely want the one. The question is, if one of these does scratch, I would probably be more interested in the one as a use than the 1A. So that's maybe something to think about. But you're going to get, if they both stay in, this one's just a bonus, and who knows, could pull it off as well. Last leg of the late pick four is the ninth race, and it's a state bred maiden special weight for 3-year-olds and up, run at about a mile and an eighth on the inner turf. And as you can see from the configuration, it starts on a turn, so horses to the inside tend to have a little bit of advantage, especially if they have some early foot. So something we definitely want to note. Number one is Stowe on the Wald. This is one case in point to a degree. This one debuted with a career high buyer at 3. You always like to see that. Tends to want to be out on the front end. It's a little troubling that this one gives it up on the front end, but you know, you are coming into the second start and perhaps can build on that. Jaime Torres is not the greatest turf rider, and he's not riding very well right now, so there's a couple of concerns there. David Donk is good with second off the layoff. So this is one that maybe at 8-1 is a halfway decent price, because it's probably going to try to wire it, and you never know, might be able to steal it. Number two is Over the Cap. Linda Rice trains. You got Jose Ortiz aboard, and they're a red hot combination, clicking at 31%. Linda Rice is okay with the second turf. I mean, second start, she's pretty good as well. But I think this one would have to make a pretty big leap to be competitive here. That was a maiden claimer for Barry Schwartz, who's a pretty good owner. That would be a little bit of a red flag to me. Is it, why is this one running for a maiden right off the bat? Did okay. Maybe did a little running late, but I'm going to want to wait one, especially since Jose Ortiz was in the irons for the debut. Vince the Prince. Trained by Michelle Nevin, as we've noted several times. You know, the barn's clicking pretty well right now, and you get Kendrick Carmouche aboard. This is the third off the layoff. I never like to see a horse debut with a career high buyer and then regress in the next start. That just sends to me that this one was all keyed up, running after the layoff, and was all raring to go, but didn't build on it, and that's the really big concern to me. It's hard for me to get by that, and plus, if you consider that Michelle Nevin is 0-10 with third off the layoff on the turf, I'll pass. Tony O is just sort of running the same race the last couple. Gets out to the lead, rates right behind the leaders, and then falls back, and ends up an okay fourth. Nothing really to get excited about. It is third off the layoff. I mean, maybe that's something, but this one seems to be stuck in a holding pattern, and I'll pass on there. Ferris Mueller, on the other hand, is pretty interesting. I don't know a lot about this trainer, Oliver Hosang, and I don't know much about Gigi Richards either, except that he was 0-14 in 2023. Not good. But this one ran a really nice, had a lot of kick at the end of the last race, and really, to me, in watching it, it was more the jockey's error that kept him from winning the race, because he had a fairly decent placement early on, and he just let him drift back so he could circle the field to make a late run. I don't know necessarily that he had to do that, and it seemed to me it cost him enough ground that it cost him the race. However, you could see moving to turf was obviously the right move for this one, and I believe it's the career high last buyer, so I think you have to use, because another effort like that would certainly put this one on the mix. Valentino's here, trained by Bruce Brown. This one, it seems to just keep running the same race over and over again. You know, the buyers may change a little bit, but he ends up fifth, and kind of a non-factor fifth. So I don't see progression here, and, you know, I think maiden claiming is next for this one, but I don't see this as a win candidate here. Slap in the Face is interesting. You got Anthony Dutrow training, and this one's getting Lasix for the first time. He's 31% with that. It's also a first-time gelding. And in the last race, it looks a little better than it actually was. He lingered in the back, didn't do a whole lot of running, and was a little uncomfortable back there. But then kind of kept on and rallied fairly well. And that was a pretty good effort for the first start. Coming in second off, they've been working this horse very steadily. I think he's got 9 works since the layoff. So this one's primed and ready. Anthony Dutrow is pretty good with long layoffs. And again, the first Lasix is a good angle. You're getting 15-1. And then this is a race where overlays are really welcome. It's kind of hard to differentiate a lot of them. So I think you want to use this one. One Headlight is illogical. It's Todd Pletcher and Rod Ortiz. Third start, 2 seconds in a row, getting a little better each time. Rapoli Stables, no reason to knock, and you have to include. Mudville 9 is debuted at turf and did not get the career high buyer, and actually ran a pretty poor race. You can see he was a little keen early and then just fell right back. It's not a good sign. It doesn't look like this one's ready to improve. Moreover, the last couple of starts you see checked, impeded, lost footing, stumbled. This one looks green and finds trouble, and I don't want any part of it. Zapruder is kind of interesting. You're trained by Belmont, and you got Jose Lascano in the irons, and they click at 24%. So, and Jose Lascano is a pretty hot rider right now. If you looked without the connections, if you looked at this horse, you might want to pass. But knowing Belmont and knowing that coming, debuting at 3, this one is likely to show improvement, probably back on a surface that might be more comfortable with. We can sort of draw a line through that debut, and I'll expect a better effort. At 15-1, it's not often you get Belmont, so in this field in particular, maybe this is one you give a chance. Number 11 is Lock and Key. It's an also eligible. There's 2 in this race. This one's made a steady progression. You can see getting a little better every start. Now you're getting an extra panel. And you do see the note belatedly here. This one runs from behind, so the more distance it has, the better off it is. So it's very possible that this one could be a contender. So this one you might want to consider if he draws in. Caesar's Ghost. He's got a Z pattern right off the bat. You can see good race, bad race, which is never good. Debuted at 3, paired the high buyer, which is okay, and perhaps a little better is in the offing. But seeing that pattern there, it really turns me off to this horse, and I would just I'd wait one. I'm not going to bother. Here's our ticket for the late pick 4. There's no singles in here. Maybe if you want to be bold, you could single in the 9th, the number 8. But I don't know. It looks pretty wide open to me. Anyway, in the 6th race, we're going to use 1, 6, 9, and 10. The 7th, 1, 3, 4, and 8. The 8th, 1, 3, and 4. And in the 9th, 1, 5, 7, and 8. So that's a $96 ticket on a 50-cent base, and I think that gives us a lot of options. There's a couple of those races, particularly the first couple, are pretty wide open. So we'll take our shot there, plant our flag, and hopefully it'll come through. Man, I love being outside. I hope it's nice where you are. It's a pretty tough sequence. I hope our analysis helps you with your wagering, and I wish you the best of luck as always. Go try something a little different. later this week for you West Coast subscribers.